the recording, sir.
Okay, madam. Okay, madam.
Yeah, yes.
So you can start recording because yes, I will. I'm just starting with installation of this Qolex.
Okay.
So fine. Maybe if it is there in the video later, students can or maybe like participants they can follow it.
Okay, fine, sir. Fine.
Okay. Okay, so I'm just trying to reinstall because something happened.
sir.
Hello. Yes, ma'am.
Sir, can I just start with the introduction and then we can proceed?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good morning. It gives me immense joy to welcome you all to the fourth day of the 1 week faculty development program on research ethics and characterization techniques in material science, organized by the Department of Physics, Bishop Moore College, Mavelikera, in association with the Guru Angad Dev Teaching Learning Center of MHRD, SGTP Khalsa College, University of Delhi, and St. John's College, Agra. Before we proceed to the session, I would like you to take a note of the following points. Kindly make sure that your audios and videos are switched off throughout the session unless instructed otherwise. Please ensure that you're online throughout the session as your attendance will be monitored. Kindly post all your queries related to the session in the chat box. The resource person will address them towards the end of the session. The deadline of your assignments has been extended to 10 p.m. 16th of September 2020. You have been provided with 4 assignments in total, out of which you are supposed to submit 2. You are expected to submit at least 1 from 1A and 1B, similarly 1 from 2A and 2B. The quiz link will be sent only to those participants submitting the feedback. Kindly make sure that the quiz is submitted before 8 p.m. For the successful completion of this FDP, you are expected to submit 1 project as well, the details of which will be provided soon. We are happy to have Dr. Madhu Chennabasappa, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, Siddhaganga Institute of Technology, Tumkur, as the resource person for this session. Madhu sir will be taking forward the discussion from where he stopped on Saturday. On behalf of the organizing committee, I welcome you, sir, to deliver the lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Good morning, everyone. So I think there was a lot of issues with respect to Colex and some other things. So what we will do today is I will start with the same Colex. So it is very difficult to follow sometimes if you're new to the software. And then I think to get hands on that, you need more time. So what I will suggest is I will do 2 times. The same things I will do 2 times. Everything I will repeat it, because that will be better. But if you know the software and everything, you can start doing from the first time. Okay. And then second time, it will be repetition for you. But if you don't know the if you are very new, like if your first time you are doing this, if you are using this software, any software, okay. So then what I would suggest you is you just take a paper and pen. In the first time when I am doing, just write it down. So if I say okay, I click on file, then you write file, and then I will say import. So you write import. Okay. So all these things you can do in the first trial, okay, when I do the first trial. Second trial, what you can do is you can try to do along with me. So that will give you some, I think that is one way you can start learning. But this is not, so you, if you are not able to follow, don't worry, because we are going to provide videos of all the sessions. So you can still try to if you have your videos, you can pause anytime, you can play it again, and you can try to practice later at the later stage. Okay. So as such, this ritual refinement itself is very, very vast. So it would be difficult to learn everything in one shot. So or in one go. Okay. So in one go, you cannot learn. Even for me, I took almost like 6 months to even get used to this, all these things. So if your first time, don't have to get disappointed. So it happens. Some people, they can get it in the first go, but sometimes you need to do a lot of iterations. So you have to do a lot of practice. So it is fine. So as long as you have some video and all those things, you can try to do it again, okay, in the later stage. Because all the videos would be shared. They are going to put everything on the and then on the internet, and then they will give it to you, okay? So this is what I thought, because even for 20 people, I saw some people used to struggle even in offline session. Okay, so normally I used to do only for 20, maximum 30 participants. So, but now as it is online, I know like even it will be more difficult. So I will try to do it a little bit slow, but I cannot do very slow. The reason being, we need to still cover a lot of things. Okay. So I'll just brush up the things what we did in the previous session. Okay, so this for analysis, we know like okay. So we started. We had to start with good X-ray diffraction data. So you had to check the quality of the data. Quality of the data means you should have very well-defined peaks. Means if you have two peaks, then they should be visible properly. At the same time, you should have very good noise signal to noise ratio. So that means noise has to be less compared to the signal. Okay, if you have too much noise, then it will be difficult to pick the small reflections. For example, in this case, this 331 or 311, these reflections are very, very small. And if I have too much of noise, then it will be difficult. And even I have shown what are the things we did in the what are the things we need to take care when we have to do collecting the data. Okay, so you have to take good data. Then in the previous class or previous session, we tried to do the upper one. So we checked the data, it was good. Then what we did, we tried to find the peak position and intensity, and this we try to match with whatever is reported. Okay, so this is what we call as phase matching. So using some Quellex, Jade, or you have so many other things. So Quellex is only free software. Rest of them are most of them are paid. So it's difficult to for everyone to get access. Okay, so then from this, what you get is you just get a basic idea of the symmetry and unit cell. Okay, so what is the possible symmetry of your sample, and then and also you will get if it is a mixed phase, whether it is mixed phase or if it is a single phase. Those things you get in this part. Okay, but what we are going to do today is we are going to go to the analysis. Okay, so whatever values you get here, the unit cell values, these are not from your sample. It is from the reported values. But today we'll try to find the symmetry. We'll try to match the symmetry for your sample, and we'll also refine the unit cell parameters. Later in the day, we are going to do the retool refinement, which should give the complete crystal structure of your data. Okay, so this will be the plan. So we'll see. So as we had some problem with the previous session, so I'll just go through it. Okay, so this is okay, phase matching. So as we know, like I think I'll skip this because we have covered this. So I'll just come from here, because rest of things we have covered here, right? So if it is how to do the matching, you should take your data. For example, this is your data from your sample. Then you try to match with the possible ingredients or precursors. Okay, so if I start with SiO2 and NaCl, and if I mix it, so my precursors would be SiO2 and NaCl, or some other, maybe if there is a reaction, then maybe a product of some of these things. Okay, so what I do is I'll just start with that, then I match it. So when I match, what are things I need to take care is the reference pattern here in this case, it is shown in lines. Okay, and the observed pattern, it is shown in, or the data from your sample is in the black line. Okay, so you get this kind of peaks. So if you see each of the peak, it is splitting into two. Okay, so for even at this happens more at higher angle. So 64 degree you are having two peaks, but this actually corresponds to single reflection. So the first peak is due to K alpha 1, and the second pick is due to KL for 2. Same thing here. Okay, so first one is KL for 1, KL for 2. Always KL for 1 will be the reference for us. Okay, so we are going to take matching or do anything with respect to the K alpha 1. Okay, so in this case, in the first one, we can see this is a good fit because even the small even though there is a small mismatch in the position, this can happen due to your condition of your sample. Your sample may be sintered very well, or it may be nano. So in that case, you can have some shift. Or if you are not having the sample height exactly to the reference, then also you can get this kind of small shift. Okay, but this is okay because we are able to index most of the peaks. Okay, so this peak is having the same. If you see these three peaks, so this is having the highest intensity, next this is the highest intensity, and this one. Okay, so there is small mismatch here, but this can also be taken care of. This can even be due to some orientation and those things. Okay, but if you come to the second one, so if you see in this case, so at two different angles, okay, so you have to see the entire pattern. So at the first pattern, you may say, okay, this is fine because this is almost having some shift due to some geometry of the instrument or something. Okay, but in case of your next case, if you see the other peaks, you can see these two peaks should be having same equal intensity, but there's a big difference. Okay, so sometimes this kind of variation would be there, so you should be careful when you do the indexing or phase matching. So even though sometimes what happens, this kind of unevenness can be due to some anisotropy during your sample preparation. So you need to take care of which is the peak which is having the uneven intensity variation. Okay, so this it comes with you have to keep doing some practice. For example, if this is having some reflection, so this is having but more intensity than the reported, right? So in the other case, the same thing here. Okay, this is having more intensity than the reported. So these two would have some common reflection, like 331. This can be 331, and this may be 33 or 441. So something like that. So you should see those things. If it is a systematic or repeated changes, then this can still be a good matching. Okay, phase match. Okay, so then we'll go to next one where so you can see the first one. So in this case, what happens, this is for a single phase. You can see lot of them are matching here. Okay, so this is matching, then this and this is matching, and you can see these things are missing here. Okay, so these are very very minor peaks in the sense you should take into account the intensity ratio. Okay, so this is having high intensity, next high is this one, and then next high is this one. Okay, but these are very small reflections. These may not be seen in some of the X-ray diffraction because you may not be collecting for sufficient time. So this is you can consider this. Okay, this can be possible because you didn't collect for a long time. Okay, but what happened in this case? So if you see this is the third in highest intense peak, but you are not having any peak from your sample. Okay, so then in this case, I cannot take this whatever is indexed is my solution. Okay, so you should be very careful. You should see at least the maximum intensity peaks are matching. Okay, so even though the small peaks are not matching, but your maximum intensity peak should be matching. If you are missing some reflection here, that means this is not a good match, because if I take this is 100%, this may be around 75%, this is 40%. So 40%, and this is around half of it, maybe 30%, something like that. If you are able to see the 30% peak, that means you should be seeing the 40% peak, because this is having better intensity. If you are not seeing this peak, that means this is not a good match. So I cannot consider this line as my solution. Okay, or this is not my phase. Okay, so then we already saw this kind of multi-phasing. So this also, if you have a multi-phase, it is nothing but it's just we have to take into account all the different phases. Okay, so for this, in this example, you have three phases. One is anatase TiO2, other one is rutile TiO2, and then the last one is hematite iron oxide. Okay, so if you just mix them, they may be trying to have a composite. So in that case, what happens if you take X-ray diffraction pattern, you will get X-ray diffraction pattern for X-ray peak for all the phases. Okay, so the black one is what you get from your X-ray machine. So now what you do, you just take this data, you put in a Quellex software or Jade software or whatever. If you have some software in your X-ray machine, you can still put that, you can still find the phase matching in that. Okay, so this so in that case, what happens, it's same thing. So if you take the hematite 100% peak is this one, and then next highest peak is this, and then the next highest peak are these two peaks. Okay, and if you see the pattern, it's the same thing. So if you take your experimental data, it is in the same variation. Okay, so this is having highest intensity, next this is highest intensity, and these two are the next highest intensities. Okay, so this is good. Okay, so this is a good match for hematite. In that case, what happens, these other peaks will be left out without indexing. So index, then what you do, you check for the next possible phase is there. So I will see that rutile is there. So rutile, if you see, this is highest peak, then second highest peak, third highest peak, and then these two are almost same. And if you see the even the experimental data, it is matching very well. So I am considering rutile is the second phase. And the last phase is, you can see the anatase phase, which is, this is the highest peak, 100% peaks. And then there is some variation here, okay? So this kind of thing you have. Okay, so this is good match with three phases. There is some more information that you can arrive, okay? Or you can derive from this. If you take hematite peaks, these width are very sharper, okay, compared to your anatase. Anatase, if you see, this peak is broader, and these peaks are broader. But if you consider this, any other peaks, they are quite sharp. So this also gives some information about the crystallite size. And this kind of variation should be same, okay? So it's same in the sense, so if I'm getting anatase very broad peak in this form, and if I get a sharp peak here, that means it is not a good match. Okay, so that is one more thumb rule you can keep into, you can consider, okay, before doing the matching. Okay, so these are the things that we can do with the Quellex. Okay, so I will just try to do again the Quellex. This is just, I will be quick because we have to go to the next one. So I had given so what I did in the morning is, once I came, I just uninstalled the old Quellex. I downloaded a new Quellex, and then I'm using the same new database. Okay, so sometimes if this database is not matching, sometimes there is possibility you won't get good indexing. So anyhow, today again I tried TiO2, because I have some I had given some exercise with TiO2. So this I tried these samples, but it was difficult to index. Maybe some files are missing in the database. So what we will do is, I will just take the example that I had given you in the for your assignment. Okay, so the first one, the assignment was assignment 1A. So I will just take this. Okay, so you can take any file. I'm taking the phase identification .xy. And then I'm going to, I know this is collected on copper, so I'm going to take this as copper. Okay, so first thing what you do, you go for pattern and take the background. Okay, so you can see this is the background. So when I just do with default settings, I see that some of the background peaks, lines or dots are going into the peaks. Okay, this is not good. So what I will do is, I'll click on this button, and I will click left my right mouse button. Okay, so I'm just clicking the right mouse button, so it is removing. Okay, so same thing here. I want to remove this, I'm going to remove. Okay, so I'm just going to right click if I want to remove. If I want to add something, then I'm going to put left click. Okay, so same thing for these things. So I am removing them and I'm putting the new one. Okay, so I always try to keep your background points somewhere in the middle of two peaks. Okay, so this is like base of the peaks. Don't try to take your background points in the middle somewhere here. It is not good. Okay, so this is some things which you need to take into account. So once everything is fine, then I can remove this because it is in the middle somewhere. Then what you can do is you can say, okay, whatever is selected is fine. Okay, so if I want to go back to complete view, then you have to click on the resize. Okay, so I'll click resize, then it will show all the peaks. So first thing is I did the background. Next, what is the second thing? I have to find the peak positions. Okay, so what is the peak? Where are the peaks present? Okay, so for this, always it already gives with some default values. So, but I want to improve the quality of peak selection. So what I will do, I'll just put some higher value for threshold intensity, and then I play with this. Okay, so if you can see here, it's not taking exactly just the peaks. Okay, so sometimes what happens, right now it is missing these peaks, some of the peaks here, and if I go slightly less threshold, you can see it is taking some peaks which are not there. Okay, so if I zoom this portion, you can see there is no peaks, still it is putting some thing. Okay, so this is because we are trying to do automatic. So what I will do, I cannot get always automatic. By automatic, I cannot do all the peaks. Okay, so what I do, I click on this. So this is for add peaks, same thing, delete peaks. Previously it was add background point, delete background point. So same notation, but now it is for adding the peak. So if I click this, if I want to, so I will just keep some extra peaks. Okay, so there are some extra peaks here, which is not actually, there is no peaks. Okay, so in this case, I want to delete. So what I do is, I will take my cursor close to this peak and I just give a right click. So you can see it has gone. Okay, same thing. If I want to remove this, I go here close to this line, I click. So now this black points are black lines are the ones which we are selecting the peaks. Okay, so now if I want to add a new peak, then I do what I do. I put a just a left click. So I go to peak position, I do a click. So you can see it has put the peak. Okay, so same thing here. I want to put this as a peak. I'll click here, left click. Okay, so to add it is left click, to remove it is right click. So same thing with the background points. So now what I do, I have finished some initial part. I have to move to the next one. So I can use these buttons. Okay, zoom right and then zoom left, or it is just like move to the right and move to the left. Okay, so I will try to put some lines to the peaks. Wherever I have the peaks, I'm going to put the peaks. Okay, so right now you don't have to try this, you can try later. Okay, so I'm just trying to show you. So later at the some point you can do this. Okay, so I'm trying to add all the peaks. So you can see here, as I go to the higher end after 50, you will start seeing two peaks. Okay, so these two peaks need not be always two different peaks. As I told, this can also be due to the K-alpha 1, K-alpha 2. Okay, so you should be careful. So I can remove this. If I don't want the second peak, I can remove by right clicking. Okay, so I don't want this, so I'll just right click, close, go to here and then right click. So it is removing the peaks. Okay, so this is how you can add the peaks and then remove the peaks. So I will try to do for the entire range. So I think yes, it's finished almost. So I go here, click it. So if you don't take very small peaks, it's fine, but most of the intense peaks you should take. Okay, so now if I want to unzoom it, I'm going to click on this resize. I'm unzooming, so it will do the resize. So if I'm happy with the peaks, so I have found 39 peaks for this pattern. So I'll say okay, I'm happy with this peak selection. So next, what is the thing? So if you take your folder which I sent, there is a notepad. Okay, so if I open this notepad, what happens is I will see there is some information given for this file. Okay, so the X-ray data for the sample phase identification .dat or .xy. Okay, this contains calcium, chromium, carbon, fluorine, and oxygen. Okay, so these are the elements which are present in this sample. So what you can do, you can go to this search. Okay, I want to do search match. I can directly do search match if I don't know the elements. If I know the elements, in that case, what I can do, I can go to restraints. Okay, I'll go to restraints and I will just select the elements which are present here. Okay, calcium, chromium, carbon, fluorine, and oxygen. So I have calcium, chromium, carbon, fluorine, oxygen. So these are the elements which are present in that sample. So I will just do search with constraints. Okay. So sometimes this is happening because, so it is giving the search did not produce any results. Okay. The reason here is, so I have used the Boolean. Boolean is your condition is and. And means you should have all the elements. But in some case, what happens? It may not be all elements, it may be few elements. Okay, it may be some one or two elements. So in that case, what you do is you have to use only few things. Okay, so just so it may be just you clear the selection. Okay, then what you do is I will just do with calcium and carbonate, calcium CO. Okay. So this means I am trying to index only the calcium carbonate. Okay. So if I do this with, if I just select only three, or we will do very simple one. So what are the things they had given? Calcium, chromium, carbon, fluorine, oxygen. Okay. So I will try with chromium, oxygen. Okay. So I'll just remove this, remove carbon, remove oxygen. I will try to start chromium and oxygen. Okay. So then I am having only two elements, then I will try to do search match. Okay. So you can see now it has given one of the phases, maybe Cr2O3. Okay. So now same thing, you should see these intensities. Okay. 130, 125 is fine. Okay. Then the same thing, 197, 181. So they are having same, similar, very close to some close values. So I will tell, okay, so this is what, this may be one of my possible phase. Okay. So now, this is again, if you give one more chromium oxide, so you don't have to select, this is the phase. Okay. This is the same repetition. So now I know there is a second one phase with, instead of chromium, I may have calcium oxide. Calcium oxide is very difficult to stabilize. Okay. So I will put calcium carbonate. Okay. Calcium carbonate, CaCOO. Then I'll just do search with this constraint. Okay. So if I do search with this constraint, you can see it is already giving this second phase. Okay. So then I can take the second phase. This is my second phase. Okay. So then again, it is going to give CaCOO, but this is not the proper phase. So if there is a more than one phase, you can keep doing this, but the easier one would be just go for search match. Okay. So sometimes restrain it works, but sometimes search match is better. Okay. So what I will do is I will try to do with search match. Okay. I'll just click search match. So now what happened? It is giving several combinations. Okay, you can see already calcium carbonate is coming. So if you see this, this is your experimental data, and this is the data which is coming from your standard. Okay, so this standard, it is, if you see the intensities, so they are quite okay. Some are less, but this can happen due to multi-phase. Okay, so most of them are in agreement. So what I will do is I will click, this is my first phase. So then what happens, it will remove all other calcium carbonates. It is giving the next possible element. In this case, it is chromium oxide. Okay. So you can see this chromium oxide, what I will do. So I will again check. So these intensities are okay, fine. So these are fine. So I will click this. If I click this, then it will take the next one. Okay. So this is your second phase. Okay. So if I come here, so I have taken two phases. So this is the first phase and then this is the second phase. So these are the exponential values. So but did I get or did I index all the peaks? So for that, what you can do, you can just go here. You can see here. Okay. So you can see here, this peak is indexed with 7689. What is 7689? So where is yours? This is your 7689. It is a calcite. Okay. So calcium carbonate. So this first peak is calcium carbonate. Second peak is indexed with the 6728. Okay. 6728 is your chromium oxide. But what happened to the third peak? Third peak is not having any indexing. That means there is no standard for that. Fourth is having some indexing. Fifth is having, sixth is having, seventh, eighth. These are having. But you can see the main peak, which is the highest intensity peak. In this case, it is 1000 with the intensity of 1000 is not having a indexing. That means it is not having any corresponding reported value. Okay, so now what I do is I'll go for the next one. So if you see here, calcium carbonate. So once I click the calcium carbonate, you can see it is giving a peak here. So this is 0222. So if you take 0222, this line is coming from 0222. Okay, so this is how you can index. So this is the first peak, which is at 28.27, corresponding to 28.28. And similarly, second peak is 47.01, 47.01. And if you take the intensity ratios, they are almost same. Okay, so there is some kind of anisotropy, because this is 1000 and 900. Here it is reverse. Okay, 900 and 1000. This can be due to some anisotropy. So I will say, okay, this is my third option. Okay, so once you do that, then what happens? You can check all the peaks. So if you go from left to right, you can see. So you can see here, this peak, I didn't pick it when I am doing the peak search. Still, it is giving a reflection for this small peaks. Okay, so that means we are doing very good refinement, or we have very good phase matching. Okay, so if you keep going like this, then you can see there is no peak which is not indexed. Okay, all the peaks are having some corresponding experimental lines. Okay, so this black line is for your sample. That means there is a peak that we selected, and rest these things are for your standard one. Okay, so now what we do is this is how you can do the phase matching. Okay, so phase matching, what it gives is it gives just possible phases which can be present. If it is a single phase, then you should get only one line. You don't have to do these many iterations. If it is a single phase, then you should just match one of them. Okay, I will try to do that also. One example. So now, what are the things I can get from here? If I go to click on this, it becomes blue. Okay, calcium carbonate. Then I go here and click on show card of selected phase. Okay, if I click here, then I can get the values for what are the crystallographic values. Okay, so you get the space group. You get the your ABC parameters. Okay, so these things are needed when you want to go for next phase analysis. Okay, so if you want to do profile fitting, or if you want to do ritual fitting, then these things are necessary. Okay, this will be your starting model. So this that is why your first thing what I started is we started with phase analysis. Okay, so same thing, if I want to know what are the crystallographic information, I'll go click on this, then I'll go click on the show card of the selected phase. So this will give the information about this phase. Okay, this is for chromium oxide, and this is having a space group of R-3C, and there are the cell parameters are these things. Okay, A and B, because it is a hexagonal system. Okay, so next one is your calcium carbonate. I go click here And if I again do the same show card, what it gives? It gives the information for calcium fluoride, which is your fluoride. And this is a cubic system, phase center cubic system with the EA parameter. Okay, so these things you can get. So these are the starting values that you are going to be plugging in to do the some fitting. Okay, so this is for multi-phase. Okay. So this was for multi-phase. So now what I do is I will try to get one pure phase. Okay. So let me see. So I don't know where you can have examples from different your samples or something. So I'll just take try to take this CO2. Okay, so this is this you can find it in foolproof example. So we'll see. So this is a X-ray diffraction for CO2, and this was collected on copper. So I'll just say okay. Now you can see this is having this looks like okay. This is very high crystalline. Okay, so even if you see here, it looks almost like very sharp line. But you know, this need not be always like that. Okay, so sometimes it will be having some broad peaks. So this is so first thing what you do, you go for background selection. Okay, if you cannot see the peaks, then what your background, what you can do, you can always zoom this. Okay, I will zoom it so you can see now this is the background. All right, so I will try to do the background correction for this part. Okay, so I'm zooming, then I'll go to background, and if you see there are some peaks, so what I do, I'll just remove the extra peaks because there are too many peaks or too many points. So I always get rid of the points which are in the inside the peak. Okay, so we don't want anything inside the peak. You should always try to take the points, background point, which are in between two peaks. Okay, not inside the peak position. Okay, so the same thing we are going to do in phase fitting. Okay, so we'll get rid of this, and then I'll say okay, this is fine. Next thing, what you're supposed to do, you are supposed to do the peak search. Okay, I'll take peak search. Then so you can see already this is very well crystalline. Okay, so in that case, it has almost taken all the peaks. Okay, so as it is highly crystalline, it has taken all the peaks, but I want to get rid of this K alpha 2, so I'm going to do the right click. Okay, so I go to close to the peak, and then I'm going to do right click. Okay, so this is your K alpha 2, so I'm going to get rid of that K alpha 2. You can leave it, is there's no harm in that. Okay, so just I'll leave this one. Okay, so just to show what is happening. Okay, so I'll say okay, fine. And if I resize, you can see it has taken all the peaks. This black line is the peak selection that we have done. Okay, so if this is very good example in the sense, if you see the peaks which is at low angle around 20-30, you can see the K alpha 1 and alpha 2, they are almost inside a single peak. Okay, so the difference between or the distance between K alpha 1 and K alpha 2 is very very small. Okay, and then in that case it will look like very like a single peak, but in principle there is a second peak here which is due to K alpha 2. Okay, so next, if you go to the next peak, so something here, I'll go slightly higher, you can see already it is splitted. Okay, so that means these are showing as two different peaks. And if you go slightly left, you can see here it is starting splitting, not exactly splitting. Okay, so this is one thing you need to keep in mind. Okay, so you may get you may see there are two peaks. Okay, if I go to a very high angle like 115 or 120, you can see this is looking like two peaks, but this is from the same reflection. Okay, it is not from two different samples. Okay, so this is one example, very good example in the sense we can distinguish the k alpha and alpha 2 and how they vary with respect to the angle. Okay, so now I will do the same thing. Search match, I will try to do with the restraints, okay, cerium and oxygen. Okay, and then I will give search match. Okay, so you can see right now it has already given some cerium oxide. Okay, and now if you see the intensities, this is 1000, close to 1000, 270 something, 280. Okay, and then so if you see the intensities, they are almost the same. Okay, but you can see there these peaks are missing. Okay, so in this case I don't have to go for second phase, but these things are missing. So why it is missing? You go to this peak, okay, 88. Where is 88? So 88 is somewhere here, right? So 88, it is taken 88.43, but it is not taking 88.70. okay, so 88.43 is the peak for k alpha 1 and 88.70 is for k alpha 2. Okay, so that is why it has not taken, but you don't have to go for second phase. Okay, so this is already for single phase. If I have only one phase, then this is sufficient. But this is the same thing for all other peaks after this. Okay, so you can see here, so even for higher angle, you can see it has taken the first peak, but it has not taken the second peak, because this second peak is from k alpha 2. Okay, so these things you should remember. Okay, so but if you see, most of the peaks are already indexed. So I am taking, this is my single phase. Okay, so I'll take that. Then you can see the next possible thing is something like this, but don't worry. Okay, so you don't have to worry about that. So if I want to know what are the if I zoom it out, you can see it has taken all the peaks. Okay, so there is corresponding experimental data, which is 9008. Okay, 9008 is for cerium oxide, and it is matching for all the black lines. Okay, so black line is your experimental data, and this is your data from the database. Okay, so this is how you can do the phase matching. Okay, so phase matching for single phase or multiple phase. Okay, so if I want to know what are the crystallographic information for this, so I will click here. I will see this is your crystallographic information. Okay, cerium oxide is it is crystallizing in Fm-3m, which is a cubic face centers cubic, and it has a unit cell parameter. So this is the thing you get from phase match. Okay, this is nothing more than this. So sometimes what happens, you may also get some Wyckoff position, and also you can see here there is some HKL values for the corresponding peak. Okay, so if I take 28.55 is corresponding to 111 peak or 111 reflection, and 20 next one 33.08 for 200 peak. Okay, so these are the peaks, or these are the Miller indices for that particular reflection. Okay, so I think with this I will stop here, because we need to cover some other things. Okay, so anyhow, we are going to share this video. So once you get this video, you try to see how this is happening. Okay, so all these examples are already there in your computer. Okay, you have to just take it, you have to just go for inside your bin plotter or full prof folder, you can get so many examples. Okay, you can try all the examples. So that is how you can learn. Okay, so for example, you can see here C folder. If you go to your local C folder, then there will be full prof if you have already installed it, and then there is something called as examples. So if you go to examples, then you can find so many files already. Okay, so you can try to find all these indexing. Okay, so this I think with this I will stop here, and if you have some question, we'll take question, then I'll go to the next part.
Hello, sir.
Yes, madam.
Can I read out few questions?
Yes, madam. Yes, ma'am. We will take two, three questions.
Okay. It's for inorganic. What should do for organic samples? Is it the same procedure for that samples?
Yes. For organic or inorganic, doesn't matter. It is the same procedure. Only thing, in that case, you have to go for, so if you go here in POWCOD database. So what you are supposed to do is you have to download the second one. Okay. You can see this is having very large size. Okay. So something around 1.7 or 1.8 GB. Okay. This contains all the data for inorganic and organic, both. Okay. The one you would, right now, if you have downloaded this file with 220 MB, this contains only inorganic database. Okay. So for organic, you have to download this, and then you can do the indexing. The same procedure. The procedure is same. It is not different.
Okay, sir. So next question from Sinoy. Since we are not interested in peak shape or area, but only on peak position and intensity, how critical is the background determination in phase matching? What does SQUANT FOM stands for?
Okay, so when it comes to phase matching, you don't worry too much about even the quality of data. Okay, so even if you have very noisy data, and if you are sure, like if you are getting most of the intense peak, for example, these are the intense peak. So if you are able to see this intense peak, then you can just get a rough idea about the phase. Okay. So for phase, you don't have to worry too much about the background to noise ratio. Well, so I'll just give a very rough example. Okay. If you want to do barium titanate by solid state reaction, what you would normally do is you'll take a barium carbonate and then you'll take a titanium oxide and then you start grinding it and then heating at different temperature. Okay. Or if you're doing by some chemical method, same thing, barium nitrate and then titanium isoprop oxide, you put it in an isothermal bomb, isothermal autoclave, and then you try to do it by hydrothermal method. Okay. So in those cases, if it is forming, that means if you're heating at sufficient temperature, then what happens? You get barium carbonate plus TiO2, you get BaTiO3, which is your barium titanate. But if your temperature is very less, in that case, what happens? It may form some partial phase, okay? And you can have some titanium oxide as second phase, and then maybe your barium carbonate as one more impurity. Okay, so in that case, you will have three phases. Maybe if it has formed a little bit, you have barium titanate plus barium carbonate plus TiO2. Okay, so this is how. So if you want to just to check whether it has formed or not, you don't have to worry too much about background noise. Okay, background or your signal, you can still do the phase matching. So for phase matching, it is not quantitative. Okay. It's not quantitative, it's just preliminary information that you get. So in this case, you don't worry. If you are seeing the major peaks, then don't worry about too much. Okay, so about this. Okay. Yes, ma'am. We can go for next.
So we'll go for one last question. Can we not use OR condition instead of AND for restraint search?
Yes, you can play with all those things. Why I'm not doing here is I cannot show all the things here. So you can use OR, because in that case you may get, for example, in the previous one when we had three different phase, so we can get the in the first shot. Okay, because when I used AND, it didn't give any matches. But if I, instead of AND, if I put OR, then it can give the possible combination. Okay, so it will be similar to search match. Instead of doing search match directly, you can go restrain and you can put instead of AND. So I will clear this. Then what I do, I'll put all the calcium. I have to click here OR. Okay, I can click here OR calcium. So OR C, OR O, OR F. Okay, OR chromium. So if I do this, then I can still get the indexing. So that is possible. So these things you can try out. There is nothing, you don't lose any of your data. Okay. So once you put the data here, nothing will happen to your data. So you don't have to worry about this. Okay, ma'am.
Okay, sir. So I guess you can proceed now. And the rest of the questions we'll take it towards the end of the session, sir. Is that okay for you, sir?
Yes, fine. Okay. I think it's fine because we will have to cover something. So
yes, okay. Sir. Yeah, yes, sir. Okay.
Okay, so I am going to close all these Quellex for time being. So then what I do is, let me go back to the PowerPoint. Okay, so this is how you do the phase matching to get the information. Okay, so next thing is profile fitting. Okay, so profile fitting, what is this profile fitting? So first I will show for single phase, then if I will show it for maybe multiple phases. Okay, so this peak search, what you did, this is just to identify the phases what are there. Okay, so this actually is not a qualitative analysis. It's just, it gives preliminary information about what are the different phases you have. Okay, but in case of profile fitting, you will get more precise information about your sample. Okay, so even the unit cell param, you can get the, with profile fitting, you can get your unit cell parameter, you can get the symmetry, all this information you can get. Okay, so this is why you are going to do profile matching, okay, or profile fitting by using your wind plotter. Okay, so for this, okay, so before going here, I think what I will do is I will just open one more PowerPoint or PDF. Okay, so this is just a very brief introduction for full prof. Okay, so this was done by one of us. So how to go to okay, I'll try to open in Adobe. Okay, so this is the one which was given by my old lab. So I'm just going to use that because full screen mode. Okay, so this was done by Stan, who he is the main in charge of X-ray diffraction in our institute, ICMCB. So he normally used to do this foolproof thing. So this is the general introduction for foolproof. Okay, so I'll just show what are the things we can do with foolproof. Okay, so now if you see here, so this foolproof is developed actually in Institute Laval Langevin, ILL. So this is a neutron center. Okay, they have a neutron diffraction or neutron source there, where you can do a lot of neutron experiments. Okay, it can be diffraction, scattering, topology, all those things. So this is the main guy, Carvajal. He's the main guy who is actually behind this foolproof. Okay, so he is a full-time scientist at this ILL, and he is the main person who has actually, along with some other colleagues, they have done development of this foolproof. Okay, so this foolproof is a package. Okay, so it's not just one single thing, it is a package. So this foolproof is coming with all these possible programs. Okay, so if you I'll go to my so if I open my foolproof, okay, so I'm going to open this foolproof. I think I have to go out, right? Okay. So I'm closing that, and then I'm going to just open this. So this is the foolproof. If you have installed, this is what you get. Okay. So if you see here, there are so many buttons. So these buttons corresponds to different programs. Okay. This is like one single package which is having all possible solutions for crystal for solving your crystal structure. Okay, so if you see here, this is your run edit editor. So this you can have editor. This will give the input files, all those things. Okay, so this it gives some data reading. This is a check cell. Okay, so I will show if I have time. So there is something called as deep wall and Treyor. So there is K search, edit PCR,
full proof, run for full proof, false. So these are different programs. Okay. So what you normally need, for example, in our case, so these are different programs. Okay. So we will be extensively using our WinPlotter. Okay. So this WinPlotter, I will give how to open the WinPlotter, how to input your data, all those things. Okay. So this Dickwall, Trior, or ITO, these are indexation. So if you don't know the space group, for example, I did search match, or I did the profile matching using Quellex, but I didn't get any results because this is a new sample. I have prepared a very new sample, which is not reported in literature. So in that case, what happens? You have to solve your structure starting from scratch. So scratch in the sense, you don't know the space group, you don't know the ABC parameters. So for that, what you're supposed to do is you have to use one of these indexations. Okay. Either your Dickwall, Trior, or ITO. So there are so many other things which will help you to get the space group and your ABC values. Okay. So then there is check group. Check group is, if you're doing indexation, then if you want to make sure this is a proper space group, then you're going to use this check group. Okay. So again, I may not test these things in detail, but I will provide you a video tutorial later. You can do it. Okay. So you can try that also. Okay. And then EDPCR is, the PCR is the input file for doing your full proof, whether you're doing a profile fitting or whether you're doing a retool refinement. Okay. So for these things, you need some input file, which is called as PCR. Okay. Okay. PCR is, I will call it as programmable crystallographic reader. Okay. Programmable crystallographic reader. The reason is, you can change this file as per your wish, and it will contain the crystallographic information about the or the model. Okay. Crystallographic model that can be read by your WinPlotter or full proof. Okay. So that is your PCR. Okay. So programmable crystallographic reader. Okay. So I gave this because just to make you better understand. Okay. EDPCR, it will help you to, so there is EDPCR here, right? So this will help you to, make the changes in this file. Okay. So this is almost like starting model for your fitting. And there are so many other things, so I may not go into this. One thing which I'm going to, so I'll just give you what are the things, okay? So this is annealing. This is again very high end, so we don't have to do that. So there is something called as bond STR, okay? So this actually, once you finish your retool refinement, you can run this program. So this program will give you the bond valence calculations, or bond distance, bond angles, all these things. Okay. So this is one more thing which you can run after you complete your retool refinement. Okay. So then there is a Fourier mapping. You can do the Fourier of your things, of your samples. Okay. And you can see the distribution of atoms with respect to each layer. Okay. So if you go from origin, your 000, and if you start moving from 00 to different layers, what are the distribution of atoms, that you can see in this Fourier mapping. Okay. And the last one is your Foolproof Studio. FP refers to Foolproof Studio or Vesta. Okay. So these, there are two things. You can see this blue part. This is your Foolproof. And you can see the last one here. So this is your Vesta. Foolproof Studio is, it was the old version where you can see the crystal structure. Okay. So how your atoms are arranged. So in lot of Sundarshan sir talk, you saw a lot of these crystal structures. So those things can be plotted using this Foolproof Studio or Vesta. So these are free versions. There are some other commercial available version, like your, for example, your Diamond. Okay, so you would have heard about Diamond or Crystal Maker. Okay, crystal maker and diamond, these are the things which are commercially available crystal plotting softwares. Okay, but these Foolproof Studio and Vesta are free software which are already integrated in your Foolproof suite. Okay, when you call a suite, this is a combination of all these programs. Okay, so it has a lot of programs within one under one roof. So the first thing what we will be doing is we are going to do wind plotter. Okay, so first thing you should know about this wind plotter. So I will just go out and then I will show. Okay, so this is I think I should get very white background. Better to get white background. So just a minute. Okay, okay, so fine. So I will open this here with some white background. Okay, fine. So now what happened here is okay, so this is your Foolproof suit. So you can see these are the different programs that are already under this Foolproof suit. Okay, so in this we will be extensively using your wind plotter. And also there is something called EDPCR. Okay, EDPCR and wind plotter we will be using extensively. So there are two versions of wind plotter. One is wind plotter 2006. Wind plotter 2006 is a old version. Okay, so if I click this, then I'll get a new window which is which will look something like this. Okay, so this is your one program. Okay, wind plotter 2006. Okay, then I have one more wind plotter which is the new version. This is actually updated very regularly. Okay, so every time they update this. So this is your second wind plotter. Okay, so which is a new version, the one which is in blue. Okay, the other one is in little bit of green. Okay, so this is your second wind plotter. So each one they have some advantage. Okay, so why they are keeping this old version is if you want to plot more than one data, this gives something called as there is some different use here. Okay, so if you use this, you can have stacking and all those things. So that is the reason they are still keeping this. Okay, and some of these Dickwall and ITER, so these kind of algorithms or programs, they work better in old version compared to new version. Okay, so new version, it is good for doing the refinement and all those things. So mostly we will be using the new version. So I'll just close this old version. So you can also open this wind plotter. Okay, so if you open this wind plotter again, you'll have different symbols. So this I'm going to first explain, then we'll go for the doing the example. Okay, so this is your wind plotter, new wind plotter. So if you see here, there is something called as open symbol. Okay, so this open button is used to import the data, your X-ray diffraction data, or it can be a neutron data, or it can be a synchrotron data. Okay, so it can be any data. If I want to open the data, I can either do with this symbol or I can go to file and then open. Okay, so there are different ways to open this. Then there is something called as PCR. Okay, so you can see there is a symbol called PCR. This is used to edit the your PCR file, which is your programmable crystallographic reading file. Okay, so then there is something called as run EDPCR. Run EDPCR is if you want to open EDPCR, which is your editor. So this is a if I click this PCR, I get in Notepad form, and if I click this EDPCR, I get it in GUI. Okay, so your graphical user interface to make changes for PCR. Okay, then if you see this FP red one, this is to run the Foolproof program. So that means if I want to, if I have a PCR file already working PCR file, then I can just start with this run PCR and I can do the Foolproof fitting. Okay, so this is for fitting the data, experimental data according to the PCR file. Okay, PCR file will contain all the information that is necessary for doing the fitting. Okay, So this we are going to do that later, okay? And there are some other things, you don't worry too much about this. So there is also DICVOL, DICVOL, so which is your indexing software, okay? So we are not going to use this much, but we'll be using this a lot, okay? FP, PCR, and then EDPCR, okay? So next, if you see here, this is just a very simple example. So what you can do is you can import your data and you can do some fitting on the peak fitting. Okay, so this I will skip it for now because the reason is we don't have too much time for individual peak fitting, all these things. Okay, so individual peak fitting, why you need this is to get some information about the your instrument value. Okay, so that again I will explain. Okay, so in detail. Then this is your EDPCR. Okay, so this is your EDPCR. It would look something like this. So you have different information here. So I will again go one by one. So this is for creating and modification of your PCR file. Okay, EDPCR. So you learned about, we are going to do more on WinPlotter and also we'll do more on EDPCR. Okay, and then there is some bond strength. So these things we may skip, because I will show it after doing your retool refinement. Okay, so this is for G Fourier is for your Fourier transform. Okay, so to see the Fourier transform of your crystal structure. So again, if I want to use bond strength, or if I want to use G Fourier, before this I have to do the retool refinement. Okay, without retool refinement I cannot use this. So this is these two things I will again brush up once I finish the retool refinement. Okay, so then this is your foolproof studio where you can see the crystal structure. Okay, so for example, this is a crystal structure of some sample. So you can see the arrangement of atoms. Okay, so to visualize these atoms, you can use either foolproof studio, FP studio is a foolproof studio, or you can also use the Vesta. Okay, so I think Vesta they are not touched, so I will show you the Vesta. Vesta is more easy compared to foolproof studio. Okay, so I'll show more on Vesta, and then this is some general information. So for what are the things we can do with the foolproof program. Okay, so with foolproof program you can do retool refinement for X-ray diffraction data from your lab or synchrotron source. Okay, you can also do a lot of other fittings for multi-phase fitting. You can do a preferred orientation. You can also do refinement for magnetic structures. Okay, if I'm doing a neutron diffraction experiment, then I can use the same foolproof to do the magnetic refinement. Okay, and then there are other things which you can do. So this is, I'm going to share this PowerPoint with you, so it's not a problem. Okay, so coming to how your foolproof program work. Okay, so how does it work? You take a data file. Data file is your experimental data for your sample. Okay, then you should also have PCR file. This will contain the your fitting parameters, like your ABC values, your instrumental values, and then it will also contain your space group information. All this information is in the PCR file. Then what you do, you give it to your foolproof. What it does, it does a least square fit. Okay, just a simple least square fit. This is your data, this is the equation that you are supposed to fit. Then it will try to do some least square fit, but with very complicated, not like just a straight line. Okay, so because you know your data contains a lot of peaks. Okay, and these peaks are corresponding to some crystallographic information. Okay, it is not like just fitting a straight line, y is equal to mx plus c. Instead, it will be very complex equation. Okay, so that is those information are there in your PCR file, and then it will fit, and then it will give the output. Output in the sense, it will give the fitted values. Okay, and then what you are supposed to do, you should see whether your fitting is good or not based on so I will show that again. Okay, and then if you are having very good fitting, that means you are arrived at the crystal structure or the solution for crystal structure. If your fitting is not good, then you go back to your PCR file, change the parameters, and again do the fitting. Again check if your fitting is good, So this is like a cyclic way. Okay. So this, you are going to do a lot of iterations. Iterations means a lot of trials between this fitting and your output. Okay. Based on your output, you should do more fittings. Okay. Okay. So PCR file, again, you can either open in Notepad, or you can also do it in EDPCR, which is your graphical user interface. Okay. So I will show how to create a PCR starting from scratch, and then we'll see. Okay. So, and when you come to the output, the foolproof program will give different output. Okay. So .out is your out file, which will contain all the information about the variables that you have done, what are the calculation you have done, whether you have done profile fitting, whether you have done ritual refinement. All those things are there in the .our. Okay. And there is something called .prf. PRF is your graphical output. So this actually contains the plot, which will have your experimental data, which is your IOBS, which is your intensity observed. Intensity observed is your data file. So you'll have a data file. I calculate is the intensity which is calculated by the PRF, your foolproof. Okay. And then it will also contain difference. Okay. Along with that, you will also have some HKL reflections. Okay. So this PRF will contain the graphical output of the fitted data. Okay. So how the fitting, you can, if you open your PRF file using your WinPlotter, you can see the quality of fitting. Okay. So that is your PRF file. .sum, it will give all the summary of your refinement. There is something you can also generate your HKL and your FOBS, F calculated. So these things you can also do. So this I will show one by one. Okay, how to do these things I will show one by one. So I think, okay, so now I think we'll start with so this is again the same thing. So edit PCR, you can, if you use your edit PCR, it will look something like this. Okay, so your EDPCR, the same thing you can also open using the Notepad. If I open PCR file using a Notepad, it will look something like this. It is like a numbers. This is the same program, and this are interlinked, because whatever you feed here, it will be just made it as a program file here. Okay, so this I will show one by one. Okay, so I will show one by one. So these are things you should, you are going to learn here. Okay. So what this exactly contains is, it will contain the fitting parameters. It will contain the background parameters. It will contain the number of phases. So I will do one by one. So let me not confuse you right now. So this is how it looks. Okay. So then I think I'll stop at this point. Okay. So that was your introduction for foolproof. Then let us go and start the exercise. Okay. So let me get rid of all the things. Okay. So now from QuellX, what you get is, you get some information about the phases present. Okay. So I will just take the example of cerium oxide, because that is a single phase. I will open the QuellX, which will give the ABC values and also your space group. And then what I will do, I will start with that point. Okay. So I'll be very quick in the this, then, but don't worry, I will slow down once I finish this. Okay. So I have to go to C drive. I'll go to foolproof. I'll go to examples. Then I will take CO2. Okay. So there are two things. I will see what is this. Okay. So this is not a proper one. Okay. I will take the CO2, just CO2. Now I know this is a copper radiation. So I will give okay. And then what I do, I will just do the same profile matching, or sorry, phase matching. Take the background, find the peaks position. Okay. I'm not doing very carefully because this is just to get rough information. So I know this is cerium and oxygen, and then I'll do with search. So I know this is my cerium oxide. So I'll just open this card file. Okay, so this is the card which you get. You can also get this information if I copy this and put it in a browser. This will just open the same file in a browser, but it will be from your COD crystallographic open database website. Okay, so I need, what are the information I need? I need FM minus 3M and also I need A value. Okay, so that is sufficient for profile fitting. But if I want to do a ritual fitting, then I have to go for more further. Okay, so I think so if I go back to this, okay, so I will explain this. So where is this? Okay, so in the previous case, okay, so in the previous case we went up. Okay, so I'll just show this. Okay, so just to be very pictorial what we are doing. Okay, so when I did Quellex, I did phase matching. We went up and then we did this. Okay, but right now what we are doing is we are doing this next step. Okay, so instead of 3A we are doing 3B, which is your Libe fitting for getting the symmetry, unit cell, and then your instrument parameters. Okay, so this is where we are here. So after this, we are going to do the ritual refinement. Okay, so let us not talk about what is next, but let us just focus on this thing. Okay, so I will just copy this and I will put it somewhere in the appropriate place. Okay, so I will share this slide with you, so you don't have to worry too much. Okay, so everything I will share with you. You can keep this and then you, later you can see what you are doing. Okay, so profile fitting, and we will concentrate on single phase. Okay, so now if you see here, this is what we are here. Okay, so right now we are doing in this Libe fitting. So for that you need some information. So when we say the peak search and phase matching, it was just getting the information about the unit cell and space group. But profile fitting, we need to do more than that. So for this, some things you need to take care. Okay, so the concept of peak shape. Okay, so each instrument, they have they give a data with different peak shape. Okay, if I use some Bruker instrument, it gives some kind of peak shape. If I use a Philips, it gives a different peak shape. If I use Rigaku, it will give a different thing. There is something called Steinway or something like that. So if based on the instrument and based on the geometry of the instrument, you get different kinds of peak shape. Okay, so this itself is not, it is not just because of your sample. Okay, it also depends on the geometry, what kind of slits you are using, what kind of your instrument you are using, what kind of solar slits you are using, what kind of detector you are using. So all those things will matter on this shape. Okay, so this shape will contain basically the information due to the instrument, and also the instrument information due to the sample. So you need to be very careful when you do the peak shape fitting. Okay, so ideally if you take a Gaussian, so it will look something like this. You may get in some instruments you may get this very pure Gaussian, in some instrument you may get very pure Lorentzian. Okay, but in most of the cases it is mixed. Okay, so for this you have something called as void and pseudo-void. Okay, so void and pseudo-void, and there is something called as Pearson function. This is just a peak fitting parameter. Okay, so this is nothing but it is Lorentzian to the power of m, and if I change the m, you get different this kind of variations. Okay, So for m is equal to 1, I get this green line. M is equal to 5, I get something like this. M is equal to 10, I get some different shape. Okay. So, but when it comes to void, void is, it is the integral of your Gaussian and Lorentzian. So I was not able to write entire thing. So I just wrote it like this. So it is, and if you see the sigma and gamma, so these are the functions for what the fitting parameters. Okay. So if I change the Gaussian and Lorentzian different ratios, and if I just mix these two Gaussian and Lorentzian, so you get different kinds of peak shape. So that is the void. Okay. And there is something called pseudo-void. Pseudo-void is, it is a combination. It can be product or sum. Okay. So this is how you get different peaks. Okay. And there is something called as split function. This is again very close to your pseudo-void, but more advanced one. Okay. So this, in this case, you can see the peak. For example, if I take a Gaussian or a Pearson or pseudo-void, you will have a symmetry. Okay. If I put a line like this in the middle of a peak, there is a symmetry for the peaks, whether it is Gaussian, Lorentzian or Pearson, doesn't matter, right? Or even, you know, in case of void, what happens, the peak is cut into equal half. So first half is the reflection of the second half, or second half is reflection of the first half. But sometimes in some of the instruments, you may not have that kind of symmetry. Okay. So this is for asymmetric peak, you can go for this kind of split function. Okay. So if I want to fit some peak like this, something like this, where your RHS, your right hand side width is not the same as the left hand side width. Okay. So in that case, what happens? So in that case, you can have different kinds of peaks. Okay. Sorry for that disturbance. Okay. So now this split function is mostly used because most of the instruments, they give asymmetric peak. Okay. So for that, you should be knowing what are the things we are fitting. So that is the reason I gave this example. Okay. So for example, in this case, what happens if you take the full width at half maxima? Okay. So what is the meaning of full width? You should take background. So this is your zero. For example, if this is your zero intensity, then if this is your I max, then so I max into 0.5, that is your full width at half maximum. So in this case, what happens? The full width at half maximum for RHS is not equal to full width at half maximum for LHS. Okay. So this won't be same, but when you want to take full width half maxima, you have to take both the values. Okay. This is addition of both the values. Okay. So, and even if you take the trials, all tails in the end, they are not symmetric. But if you take any of these functions, you will have symmetric. Okay. So you very symmetric, your full width half maxima at RHS is equal to full width half maxima at LHS. Okay. So these are some of the things you need to take care when you're doing the fitting. Okay. So next, let me see. I have something after this. Okay. So this is your pseudo void function. So this is how it looks. Okay. So I will again share. This is the same thing what I explained in the previous one. Okay. So, but when you take the addition or the product, it is not simple addition, but if you take the Lorentzian, it will be 1 by 1 plus something like this. So these things will be taken care by your software. Okay. So you don't have to worry much. Okay. So now this is what you should also remember. So you have a lot of alternative for your pseudo void. So the first one is your Pearson 4, and then Thomson-Cox pseudo void, and then you have split pseudo void. Then there is some other finger Cox pseudo void. Okay, so these are different functions that are used to fit the peaks. Okay, and I have just given some example here. So these are if you see with fitting, so you may not get fitting 100%. For example, at a low angle, you may not get this, you may not be able to get very good peak fitting. So the black one is from your data and red one is the from your function, okay, the fitting function. Okay, so if you see here in the lower angle, the fitting is not that good. Okay, but as you go for higher angle, so you can see the fitting is very good. Okay, so this can be reverse. Sometimes what happens, if you get very good fitting in lower angle, you may not get to very good fitting in the higher angle. So the reason for this is your FWHM will keep changing with respect to angle of diffraction. Okay, so this is one of the example where you can see here the full width half maxima is very less in the at low angles, and as you go for higher angles beyond your 80, what happens, it starts increasing rapidly. Okay, so in this case most of these functions will not be able to address. Okay, sometimes so that is the reason you may not get the fitting same in all the cases. Okay, and the same thing is shown here for I don't know, it may not be very clear, but if you take the calculated peaks, you can see this full width half maxima, calculated half maxima, it has very broad peak at the low angles, okay, like 2 theta is equal to 10, and this starts narrowing as you go to higher angle, like 30 and 80. Okay, if you go to 80 degree, it is more narrower. Okay, so these are the things you should know that is running behind in the program. Okay, you may not be able to control these things, but you should know what are the different functions. And if I have different kinds of peaks, for example, if I have Gaussian peaks, then which function I need to use, and if I have Lorentzian peak, what is the function I need to use. Okay, so these are the things you need to know when you do it. Okay, so let me now start with one of the example. So so let me start. What I do is I will just try to copy that CO2. So if I go to my C drive, and then I can find something called as FullProf, okay, FullProf suite, and then I'll see, I can say I have an example. In that, I'm just going to copy this CO2, okay, I'll copy this file, okay, then I'll put in a, maybe I'll put it inside one of this, okay, assignment one, okay, I'll copy and paste it here. So I can share with you. If you cannot find it, what I will do is I'll just put it in the chat box. Okay, so I will your computer. Okay, so desktop, and then assignment one CO2. Okay, so I'm just putting this. So if you can download, you can just download this. And then you can keep it ready. Okay, so I don't think it went to everyone. Okay, so I guess everyone got it now, right? So you can download this, or it is, if you have already installed the FullProf, it will be already there in the in your my computer. Okay, so it is already there. But anyhow, so if so a lot of people first thing what you do with when you get the data is, okay, so you don't worry about something happens for your file, you can always make a copy. Okay, so you make a copy of this. So I'm afraid something will happen to data, I'll just copy this, okay, and then I'll just paste it here. So this is a copy of that, right? So I can always open this in a Notepad. Okay, so I use something called as Notepad +++. This is again a free Notepad. So I will tell why, what is the use of this. Okay, so all if you want, you can also try to download that. Okay, Notepad +++. So this it will look something like this. Okay, this is equivalent to your this is equivalent to your Notepad, but it is a higher version. the reason why I use this Notepad++ is if some other program is using this file, then if that program is changing the file, and I can just click here and it will be updated. Okay, I will show the demo for that. Okay, so right now it will be difficult for you to assume what I'm saying. So let me tell that, I will show you that. Okay, so if you open this in a Notepad, you can see what are the things it is there. Okay, if it is some experimental, like your raw data, you won't see this. Instead, you will see some, let me see. Okay, so if it is a machine language, then you will see something like this. Okay, .raw. Okay, so this was taken on expert high score. Okay, your expert some instrument. But if you see, I don't see anything here. Okay, so it is something like it is written in machine language, which I cannot read. But if you convert that into XY format, or this is a different format. Okay, this is in a second format, which is your theta initial, theta final with some step. Okay, so now all of you, what you can do is you can just open a winplot. Okay, winplot, how to open this? You open your full proof. Okay, so this is your full proof, and then you can just click on this run winplotter. Okay, if I click on this run winplotter, I will get this file or this program. I will just try to minimize this. Okay, and then because I want to keep this two next to each other. Okay, so I will just try to, when I explain, I want to open both. Okay, so now if you have this, if you have opened this winplotter, you click on this button, open button. Okay, so I don't know how to get it. Okay, I'll try to come down. Okay, so this is if this button will open a file in a scrolling window. Okay, so if I click on this, it will show there are different formats. Okay, so for the first one, it is saying x comma y dat. Okay, so this is the instrument 10. So instrument, you need to know or remember this. I will tell why. But in our case, what I have is free F. Okay, free intensities. In bracket, it is written as TI. TI is theta initial. TF is the theta final. So in my case, theta initial is 25. Theta final is 143. Okay. And there is something called step in between. Step is, the step size is 0.025 degree. Okay. So I will click on this. That means I'm activating this. And then what I say, I'll say, okay. Okay. So I will do again. You click on the this button, you click, you select, initially it will be something like XY or something here. What I do, my file is in this format. So I will click on this and I will say, okay. And I will look for that file. Okay. So I'll go to assignment one and then I had made this. Okay. So I will take this CO2, and whenever you are having some file name, don't keep some space or some special character. Okay, so for example, I can if I have something like this bracket. Okay, so this is not good for your foolproof program. So always, if you have something space or some special character, replace it with minus sign or underscore. Okay, remove those kind of things, then it will be easy. Okay, so anyhow, in my case, I'm just taking CO2. I will I will open this. Okay. So if I open this, so you can see this is the data what I have in that file. Okay. It is having cerium oxide. So this is what we did with the Quellex. Okay. So the same thing we did in Quellex. So I'm trying to keep the same file. Okay. So I will tell you the reason. Okay. So now you can see, if I want to zoom, what I do is I will hold the left button and I will select the area what I want. Okay, so this is how I can zoom it. This is the same thing what you are doing in Quellex. Okay, same thing. And if I want to get rid of or if I want to come back to original complete pattern, then I have to just right click. Okay, if I just do a right click anywhere on the graph, it will show all the peaks. Okay, so same thing here. If I want to zoom here, I'm going to do left click, then drag the or select the area I want to zoom in, and if I want to go back, I will just do a right click. Okay, so this exercise you can do. Okay, try to do this exercise, then I will go for the next one. Okay, so anyhow, this is something you can do. So this Win Plotter, it will help in lot of things. You can do visualizing your data, you can do background selection, you can do peak selection, and you can also run the foolproof program. Okay, so these things we will do here, okay, one by one. So if you are new to this system, then you just take a paper, pen, keep writing each thing. Okay, later you can do practice. Okay, in the break you can do the practice. So this is I have imported the data. So next, what we can do is, you can see there are a lot of options here. So this, I cannot cover everything right now. Okay, so I will show some things at least. Okay, so I will zoom it here, and if I want to go to plot or options, there is something called a pattern color. Okay, if I go to pattern color, I can change the pattern color. If I don't want the blue, if I want to have it in red, I will click in red. Okay, so this will change the color. Okay, again, if I go to pattern color, if I want to take it as green, I can do it in green. Okay, so these are things you can play yourself. I don't want to spend time on this. Okay, so I will keep my default blue one. Okay, then you can also change something called as pattern markers. Okay, so pattern markers are literally, you can see there is some dots. Okay, these are the data points. Okay, I think it's not allowing. So I will make it, before it was one, I'll make it two. So now what happened is, you can see the point size, it has increased. And if I want to make it less, I can go to pattern markers, reduce this. So you can see this is almost gone. Okay, so I cannot see any points on the curve. It is just a line. Okay, so I will just keep it in default version. Okay, so now if you go here, if I zoom it, and if I see these two lines, okay, if you take this point is at, what is the position of this point? I think I'll increase, maybe it's better. Okay, so this is better, right? So if I take this point, if I bring my mouse close to this point, you can see in the bottom, okay? So in the bottom somewhere here, there is something called as X and Y, okay? I think, yeah, it's better like this. So if I bring it here close to this, then you can see in this X and Y, it will change to 2 theta and Y. Okay. So 2 theta is 33.09. And if you see D value, and if you see the wavelength, it is given. Okay. So, and also it is given the intensity. Intensity is Y. Y is 7793 in this case. Okay. So this is how you can read the position of your peaks. Okay. So this is your K alpha 1 peaks. This is your K alpha 2 peaks. So if I go at higher angle, so you can see the K alpha 1 peak is at 114.71, and K beta peak is K alpha 1 peak is at 114, K alpha 2 is at 115. Okay, 115 is your K alpha 2 peak. Okay, so this is how you can read the peak's name. Okay, so this is the use of this thing. So I will again reduce this. So next, what are the things you can do is, for doing profile fitting, you need to give some information. Okay, you need to do background, you need to do peak search or peak position, and then you can apply some crystallography. Okay, crystallographic constraints. So before doing that, what I do is, I will try to show you how to take some other things. Okay, so here in this case, I'm not able to see the background because my peaks are very sharp. That means this is highly crystalline sample.
So what I can do, I can switch my y axis. Okay, right now it is in linear axis. I can go to logarithmic. Okay, if I go to option y, and then if I could if I'm selecting the log y, then you can see this your y axis in logarithmic scale. Okay, what is the other thing? I can also do it in square root. Okay, so this looks better in lot of things. Okay, so here or I can go for some other q2. Okay, so normally this is a linear scale. By default it will be in linear scale. Okay, so I can switch from one to other by using this option. Okay, I will keep it in square root, and then what I will do is I will show how to pick the peaks. Okay, or first is you have to take the background. Okay, so first thing, background selection, out what to do, what you do is you select some area like this, zoom it, and then you go to point selection. Okay, when you go to point selection, there is something called as automatic peak search, and we will not use this right now. We'll do select background points. Okay, so zoom the some area, then go to point selection, and then select, click on the select background point. Okay, so if I click background, my cursor will change. Okay, it will change to some plus point. You go to the place wherever you want to add the background. Okay, so I'm just adding this background, something like this. Okay, you have to just click left click. Okay, you go to the place wherever you want to select the background and left click, not the right but the left click. Okay, so you just select all the points. So when you select, so you can see when I'm selecting, I'm trying to select in between two peaks. Sorry, in between the peaks. Okay, not in the middle of the peak. Don't take in the middle of the peak. Instead, you just click on this flat area. Okay, so then if I want to move right, I'm going to click here this red button. So you can see it is moving right. Then what you do, you try to select all the background. Okay, so these are some of the things which you can select. Okay, so you try to select more background or more points for your background. If you have more points for the background, is good. Okay, and this is what we call as manual background. Okay, so there is other ways of selecting background. So there is something called as automatic background, but that is not good. For a beginner, I will better always go for manual background for selecting background. Okay, so once you are happy with background selections, then what you do is you have to save these points. Okay, so whatever there in the red, those points has to be saved. What, how to save it? Go to again point selection, and there is something called save background points. Okay, point selection, save background points. So if I click this, it will say, okay, do you want to save? Yes, I want to save. So then you can give some name for this. I'll call it as cerium or CO2 background. Okay, so it will save in .bgr. Okay, so I can save it. So it is telling that you have selected 25 points. Okay, fine. And then it will ask, do you want to open it? If you want to open it, you can say yes. Normally you can just tell no. Okay, so if I open it, you can see it has given all these points. Okay, and you see this by mistake I clicked here. So I just want to get rid of that. What I do is I'll just delete the last point. Okay, and now it became as 24 points. You don't have to do it. Okay, only I did some mistake, so I will did like that. Okay, so or now what I will do is I will repeat the same thing. Okay, I'm going to reset it. Okay, if I click the reset, then what happens? It will remove everything whatever is there in the screen. Okay, again I want to import, so I'll go to this button, import. So it is already there in the instrument zero free. So I will select that, then I will select the data I want to import. Okay, so now, so as I cannot see the background, I can do like this also. Okay, so I can zoom it. Now I have to do first background selection. So what I do is I go to
point selection, select background points, and I will start putting the points here like this. Okay. So this is in linear scale. The previous one was in logarithm scale. Okay, but everything is same. It doesn't matter. It don't make big difference. Okay. So I'm selecting all the points which are possibly the background. Okay, in between I'm just clicking like that, and then what I do is I will, once I get all the things, all the background points, you can take more points. I'm just for demo, I'm taking very less points. Okay, then I want to save. So point selection, save background points. Yes, I want to save this. So what I will do is I will just put okay, it has gone now. Found. Okay, so background one. Okay, so save. Same thing. If you, it has selected 20 points, fine. Do you want to open? I don't want to open. Okay, so now you have selected the background. Okay, so this you just do a practice. Then I will show how to create the PCR file. Okay, so now so if you have any doubts, you can ask. Madam, if you have any, if they have question, I can address.
Sir, in the present session, we don't have much question.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think I will go. I will proceed for some more time. Maybe I will take some 10 minutes. Then I will stop it. Okay.
Fine.
Because I need to cover some things.
Okay.
So now you know how to open a. How to open a data file, how to do the background correction. Okay, so now what I will do is I will show how to create a PCR file. Okay, so if you click here, it will say, okay, you can open the PCR file, but if there is something called as EDPCR, okay, if you go here, it will say run EDPCR. This is nothing but edit PCR file. Okay, you can create a file, you can do or you can just do modification to the PCR file. But there is, if you don't know how to get the PCR file, then what we can do is, so I will tell you how to do some PCR file. Okay, so PCR file, it will contain information about the space group. It will contain information about the background of the file. It will contain information about the type of data file you are using. It will contain information about the peak shape that you are fitting. Okay, I showed you different peak fitting parameters. So all those things you will see in the PCR file. Okay, so that is why I covered those things before starting the fitting. Okay, so now how to get the CIF file. Okay, so I think I have provided you some CIF file. So you can already start with that file. Okay, so what I do, I'll go to full proof. So I think this is fine. You should see something called, I will click this EDPCR. Okay, so you can open EDPCR, it will look like this. Okay, so go to WinPlotter and then click EDPCR, or you can even from full proof, you can, there is a EDPCR, you can click here again, it will open the same thing. Okay, so either you can click on full proof or you can click on WinPlotter. Okay, so EDPCR you can open from anything. Okay, it is already linked. Once you install full proof, the program will link these things. Okay, so if you click this EDPCR, run EDPCR from either from full proof or from your WinPlotter, you will get this new window. Okay, so now I will show what are the things you can do. Okay, so this EDPCR, you can create a new PCR file. Okay, program crystallographic data file, or you can open an existing file, or you can also convert your CIF file. CIF is, CIF refers to crystallographic information file. Okay, so I think somewhere I'll put it. Okay, so I'll put here. Okay, CIF refers to crystallographic. Crystallography information file. Okay. That is your CIF, okay? Crystallographic information file. So this file, you can actually get it from a online, okay? Or you can get it from, you can download it, okay? So lot of publication, they give this CIF file along with your, in the supplementary data, okay? But there is one more way how to get it, okay? So you just open your browser, okay? And then what you do is take a new I think my computer is slow today, I don't know, or okay, only this program is not working. So okay, so what you can do is there is a web page which is called as materialsproject.org. okay, materialsproject.org. okay, so you can just go to this website. So I think I already gave something for TAO2 somewhere here. I here. Okay, CIF file. This if you can go to this website. This I have already given example for titanium oxide. Okay, titanium oxide CIF file. You can get it from this webpage. Okay, so I will try to open that. And then what you can do? You can create a PCR file directly from CIF. Okay, so I had already given some files. Okay, if you go to your the files that are provided with you, okay, there is first thing called as one convert CIF to PCR. Okay, if you open this, there are some PCR files. So what you can do is you click on this cancel. Okay, so you click on this CIF to PCR, okay, and then you go to that particular file. So if I want to convert this CIF to PCR, I will just click this PCR, open the PCR, okay, open PCR, then it will say it will just give some information here. Okay, you are using X-rays or whether you are using neutrons. So I will say I am using X-rays, then I will say okay. Okay, so now if I say if I click this, so before that what I will do is I will try to open that particular folder. Okay, convert. So you can see there are some 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 files. All files are CIF files. So crystallographic information file. Okay, so it is already written here, right? So you have only CIF file. So now I have opened one of the file, which is your cerussite. I opened it in edit PCR. Now once I click save button, okay, so what I'm going to do is I'll just click this save button. If I click the save button, you will see there's one more file coming here. Okay, so I'm going to click this save. So you see it is created one file here. So what is this file? This file is PCR file for cerussite. Okay, so this is how you can convert your CIF file into PCR file. Okay, later I will show how to modify that file. So I'm just showing you different ways of creating a CIF file. Okay, so now if I want to so my browser is on. So what I will do is I will click this. Okay, I will open that. Try to open that web page. Okay, so I think I don't want to do this. I will just open materialsproject.org. Okay, just. I don't know, my network is slow a little bit today. Okay, so if I go to this web page, it will ask initially to sign in. So similar to your Quellex, this is a free web page. It's not like your ICSD or ICDD or JCPDS file website where you need to pay if you want to use it. But this is a free, you can use it for free. So all you need to do is you have to just register it either using your Google or anything. So I have registered it with my email. I will try to log in. So you know, I didn't use it from long time. So then what I do is, as I have already registered, I'll put my email ID and I will ask the website to send a login link. Okay. So now it has sent a login link. What I have to do is I'll just have to go to my email and I need to just open it. Okay. I don't have to, they will send a link. And if I click that link, then it will give access to that website. Okay. So this is how you can just log in into that website. I think I have to wait a little bit. Okay, so materials project, I got a link. So what I do, I just go here, click this link. So it will automatically log me in. Okay, log me into that website. Okay. So why, what is the use of this is, if you don't have SIF file for a given material, for your material, you can always search in this web page. Okay. So it is a free web page where you can search for your SIF file. So I will try, what I will try to do is I will just try to show to download that and then we will take a break. Okay. So I think if that is fine, so. So my internet is slow. I don't know why. Okay. So it gives some message. It's fine. So now you can see here. It gives a periodic table. So I want, as we are trying to solve CO2, I will check Ce and O and I will do a search. Okay. If I do a search, then what it does is it will give some it is loading here. Okay, so it will give some reported SIF files. Okay, I can download the SIF file here directly and I can do the rest of the my ritual refinement. Okay, so I think what does this SIF file contain? So you can, if you are curious, I'll just open it and show you. Okay, so this, I'll open it in Notepad. So this actually contains the information about the crystallographic information. Okay, so you, if you see here, if you just scroll this SIF file, you see the ABC parameters is there, ABC parameter, alpha, beta, gamma parameter. Okay, then it is also having the space group parameter. So this is your space group and this is the corresponding space group number. Okay, either you can give a space group or you can just give the space group number. It will also contain the allowed symmetries for this space group. And then if you go down, you can see there is something called as your Wyckoff positions. Okay, so if you want to do ritual refinement, you need these Wyckoff positions. That is your atomic coordinates. That is nothing but the position of your atoms. Where is your PB? Where is your carbon? Where is your oxygen? Okay, so those are the Wyckoff positions which will give the atomic position of each element. But for profile matching, we need just only these things. Okay, I need information about A, B, C, and also the space group. Okay, if I have those things, I can just do the profile matching. But if I want to do ritual refinement, then I need A, B, C, space group, and also atomic coordinates. Okay, so this is what is there in your SIF file. Okay, so I'll see. Okay, so you can see here.
it has given lot of options. Okay, so you can C2O3 exists, CO2 exists. So I don't know whether this exists, but if I come back to my Quellex, so what is what does the Quellex suggest? It suggests a FM minus 3M cubic parameter, cubic cell with 5.39 as the cell parameter. Okay, so it is a cubic parameter, cubic unit cell. Okay, so now I will go back to that web page and I will see for this FM minus 3M, and my sample is CO2. Okay, here it is showing like serum 0.5, DY 0.5, and O 1.75. But in our case, it is a cerium oxide, CO2. Okay, so I think yes, it is in the wrong position. Okay, so if I check here, it is CO2 and with FM minus 3M. So I will go back to website web page. So I will click this. If I click this, then it will open in a new page. Okay, so it will open the entire information about CO2. Okay, so then, so these are the things that you can see in the new page. Okay, so if you go here, it will say SIF. You can download the SIF. Okay, you can conventional, you just download the conventional standard. Okay, so if you just click on download, so you can see it has already downloaded the file. So what I will do, I will go to that folder, my download folder. So this is the one which just recently, like 11:43, it has downloaded. I am going to copy this into the folder where I am keeping my So it is in assignment one. So I'm going to copy this. And if I open this in a notepad, so in I should see all this information. Okay. So I should have this space group. Okay. And then, so space group is written here. And then the ABC parameter is written here. And I can also, I can also see the allowed Wyckoff position for this. Okay, so sometimes what happens, it is not giving exactly the same space group, it is giving some other versions, but it's fine. You can try different you can try to download different files. Okay, so you can go to a good PCR file. So normally this is okay, this is fine in this case, but if you're having more than one, so for example, you can see here. So CO2, there are in a different space group, but this is a tetragonal space group, which is not of our interest. So you should check what is the proper one. Okay. So I4MMM, no, it is not one. And then P63 by MMC, this is not the one. P42 by MNM, this is not the one. Okay. So you, the right one is FM minus 3M. So here it is CO, but in our case, it is CO2. So this is the only thing which is for CO2, FM minus 3M. Okay, so you can download that and you can convert that into PCR. Okay, but I will show to develop your own PCR. Okay, starting from scratch. Okay, you don't have to take the PCR file from your website. Okay, but if you don't know the information, you can always go and download it here. Okay, from there. So right now, I think I will stop it here, and we'll let us take some 20 minutes break, and I will come back. Okay, is it fine?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So we'll meet after 20 minutes, sir. So can we start by 12 o'clock, sir, or should I make it 12:15? 12 o'clock, is it fine, sir?